Hey guys, welcome to another video of API pen testing. So if you are new to this video, then please go ahead and watch the previous video where I have talked about the basics of API pen testing, like how the API work and how to find some of the vulnerability, how to approach towards API pen testing and all those things. I have also gone ahead and explained about SQL injection, which might be helpful for you. So please go ahead and watch the previous video. And another request is to please, please, please watch the complete video so that you get some idea. Do not skip the video. I have seen a lot of people actually watching for five, or like initial 5 minute or 2 minute, and then skipping to the end. So don't do that. Probably you might lose the concept or the words that I say, because I majorly try to give you the concept of the approach towards API pen testing rather than just show you some demo. So I could have easily gone ahead and made some demo and just publish it, right? But it's important to talk about the approach, which will help you, because the practical which I show you might not be applicable or not be that straightforward for finding a particular vulnerability. So please understand the concept or the approach and then go for following the complete video or watch the complete video and then go for security testing. So let's start with today's topic. But before that, if you are new to this channel, then please go ahead and smash the subscribe button, hit like, share with, and if you have any query, do write in the comment box. So I will definitely try reply. Again, don't reply or post comment in type Facebook post or something. Do reply in the YouTube channel only so that I can go ahead and respond to you one by one, because I almost responded all my comments since YouTube. So please do write in the YouTube comment box. I will definitely try and answer. So let's jump into today's topic. So in today's topic, we are going to further extend whatever we have been doing about API pen testing. So I might not show you all the demo of all each and individual vulnerability, but if you need any demo for me to make, then please do write in the comment box. I will definitely try and make it. But however, I will give you the concept or the approach that you can apply for performing security testing on API. So let's jump into it. So if you could see here, last time we just saw about how we can use this user ID and password value to successfully generate the token, user ID, and along with the username, right? So this is the basic information or basic calls that we ran basically. So now let's go ahead and run another call basically, which is to retrieve user information, right? So this is the particular call. As I said, it is very important to know the documentation of your API calls for finding out any vulnerability. So if you could see that this is basically the call, and this is used to retrieve user entity in user database. So this is the format that we have to maintain. Again, he has provided the request call or body call. So I go back and I go to repeater, which we have been using earlier. So I see here for user one, pass one, I have just generated the expiry token value. Expiry and the ID, probably this is the token and the user ID value. Right, so let's go ahead and run for the other call. Now, one more thing, if you could see here, that JSON or JS Beautifier is one of the extension that I have installed. You can find the extension inside your extender tab or Bob suite. So you can see JSON/JS Beautifier, which is really helpful while performing security testing. So you can definitely go ahead and reinstall just to show you demo. It's as simple as it is. Now, one more prerequisite for this JS Beautifier is you need to have Jython basically. So I have just gone ahead and downloaded Jython standalone, and I'm just using it as simple as it is. Now, if I go back, probably this has been installed. Yeah, so this has been installed, JS Beautifier. And if it is installed successfully, you can see this response with a particular tab basically, or request particular tab, JSON/JS Beautifier. Similarly, you can see in the response. So in some of the cases, it will come. Now let's go ahead and name this as an authentication, because this is just for user ID and password and getting some of the token value. The next step that we are going to create is, yes, I'm going to say another, okay, create one more tab, which is basically for your user data retrieval. Okay, and to get user data, this is the particular call that we have to follow basically. So I'll simply copy paste this request, whatever as per the structure. Now, as per the request format, it just only need the auth token, which is nothing but the value that we have received from here. So this one. Now, please do set up this lab in order to practice if you want to, because this is the really nice lab, I would say, just to showcase the demo. So I will just simply put this token value, and Okay, so we don't need, this is a get request. Basically, if I see this is a get request, so we don't need this value. So I will just simply delete it. So all I am doing initially is running as per the structure. Then we will think about finding out vulnerability. So let's just submit it. Now, as soon as I submit this, okay, this is just not token. This will be your user as per this guideline, right? As per the documentation. So we'll just send this particular value and send it. Now, if you see here, that X auth token equal to whatever the token value that I have provided, and I could able to see basically the user ID and password value. Now let's talk about here the vulnerability that can happen over here, right, before jumping into the further exploitation. Now, if you have noticed in my previous video, I have provided you one API security checklist inside the description box. I don't know how many of you see that, but this is really important while going for security testing of REST API. So first and a very important part of any web application or API security pen testing is your authentication. If you are able to find some vulnerability in the authentication, then that will make more damage or more severity than any other vulnerability. So do focus more on your authentication part only. So the first thing it says, like, don't use basic authentication. Yes, basic authentication is really, really weak. The two reason to it is like, it will be typically inside your header value only. And the other thing is like, this will be something your base64. So let me show you one of the simple structure or the example. If you go to the decoder, let's say user one colon password one. Now, if you see something like this inside your authorization value or something, let's say over here, if you see here the xauth token equal to this particular value, then you can definitely say this is they are using the basic authentication, because it's really easy to decode the password or decrypt the password, and we can easily go ahead and know the clear text value of the user ID or the password that it's been using, right? So basic authentication is really, really dangerous. So I would suggest never ever see, if you find anything basic authentication, then go ahead and report there itself so that you get some vulnerability, right? The first point. Now let's talk about some of the more checkboxes. Like, one of the security testing that one of my very close friend used to do, I think Imdad. So what he used to do is every time he gets some like request body call or API testing, the first thing that he will do is test the API without the authentication token. So if you send this particular value over here, there is some validation, but most of the time or in some of the cases, you will see that your request will still be valid without the authorization token, and that is where you get a vulnerability. So always check for these particular things, like if you have authorization token or header, try remove it and test it. So over here you could see that our token ID not found, right? Because this is properly validated. But in vulnerable scenario, you will see the proper response without like the error message or something like that. So not only remove this token, try removing the whole token and then send some time. It might work. If it is a vulnerable scenario, it works sometime. That's what I have learned from Imdad long, long time ago. He was testing in this particular way. So yeah, so if you see that over here with the authorization token only or XAuth token only, we could see, but one of them, as I said, try remove the authorization token, do not use basic authentication. These are the two key learning from here. Now, one more thing is regarding the rate limit. So for rate limit is something, let's understand this, what is this rate limit basically. So you would have seen in your Facebook or Google or somewhere, like whenever you try to log in with your user ID and password and you provide 3 or 5 times wrong credential or wrong password, then you basically see an error message like, please try putting some captcha value, or maybe please try after 1 minute, 2 minute, and it goes on increasing. Also, you might have seen something like it is asking you for to identify some of the pictures like car, whatever is the umbrella, or like truck or bus, something, right? Google like PepChap, other things that we'll talk about a slight bit later, because PepChap is different thing. So we're not going to talk about that. So challenge authentication protocol. So yeah, so you would have seen such thing. So which is good, because that is a security level protection. But if there is no rate limit in place, then you can basically perform the brute force attack. What I mean by brute force attack is you can go ahead and perform multiple like attempt for password. So to demonstrate that, I would take this simple example. I think brute force attack is really simple and everybody shows that, but just for maintaining the like practical experience, I'll just go ahead and show you. So if you see here, let's say I don't know the password, right? So don't know. and this is the user 1, and I want to check whether there is brute force protection there is or not. So what I am going to do is I have just right click over here, if you see in the repeater, and send it to intruder. As soon as I send it to intruder, this is the value that typically comes over here, and I'm just going to, since I know the username, I don't need to brute force for the username. But if you need to brute force for the username, then you need to click on this particular tab also. Now all I have to do is send some of the payload. So let's say I'm sending some of the payload like test, user, hacker, admin, okay, new user, password. Password doesn't have to be like character only, so you can put some of the special similar other thing, right? So as soon as you provide the list of payload and you click on start attack, and basically you will see that a brute force attack will go from Bob suit. Now these days there is Turbo Intruder also, which will make another video sometime later, but just for understanding right here, I will show you with the usual intruder value. Turbo Intruder basically is really fast thing. So it will, over here you could have seen like 20 requests for let's say 3 seconds, but with Turbo Intruder you can send 2,000 basically requests in 3 seconds. So that's the power. Now if you see here for the wrong credential, now as soon as I perform a brute force attack or intruder attack, I always try to sort based on status code and your length value. So for write password, if the status code change sometime, it changed to 302, then it will be basically a vulnerability. You will get an directly brute force protection over here. I mean, it is not a vulnerability. You will be able to notice or analyze the intruder output properly with that way. Now, if you see here, all the status code has not changed, all for 200. Then we have come to the second parameter, which is your length. Now, if you see for write credential, the length value basically changed at 274. And the particular password for this particular user 1 is on request number 12, which is pass 1, right? And the length value is 274. Now, whenever you see some change in response value, you can response length, you can go and check the response value. So over here, you can see that you got a proper response. So that means it confirmed that pass 1 is your right password, and for other you see 183, which means password doesn't exist. So this is a simple demonstrate in quick time about intruder attack, which everybody or most other people know is. Now again, coming back over here, so we have just saw like how user retrieval we can do with the proper X authorization header. Now a few more issues that you can check for whenever you have some authorization token or something, check for the expiry length. If you have something, a logout API call, then hit the logout API call and see if the token is basically expiring or not. If it is not expiring, then that will also be an issue, like the token doesn't expire in the server and rather than it expiring the client end, which is pretty rare, but yeah, it's issue, because most of the time in API level, basically you will have a particular timer, like the token will be valid for 2 minutes, 5 minutes or 10 minutes as per the requirement. Most of the time developers keep, they don't keep it for like logout button or something, but you will have something like 2 minutes or 3 minutes. So it should be as less as possible. I do not recommend to keep it like for 30 minutes or 1 hour, but it is less than it is good. Now, if you go back to this authentication, so we are talking about the brute force attack. Now, there is one more thing. Even if there is a rate limit in protection, then you can still also able to bypass this brute force protection or rate limit by using some of the special header. So I will show you another link over here. So I'll say like, I am not going to use the direct link basically, but another link. So ports, weaker, or WAF. So this is another article, which is really nice one. Now, I think yeah, this one. So over here, you could see that X originating IP. There is things like local host, or you can also provide your IP address instead of that. So the way you can utilize for performing your brute force or rate limit protection is like, let's say I'm showing you for this example. And if I am going to add something like this, okay, as after this content type only, I will add something like this, X originating IP. Then sometime it doesn't work. Sometime there is the rate limit bypass you can achieve by using this kind of special header. You might have seen some of the HackerOne report, but this is the for real, you will find. So do not always trust for like this 127.0.0.1. You can also use your host IP address or whichever the domain, I mean IP address or something, or in any internal address also sometime work. There is also, I think, one extension in Bob Suite named as IP Rotator, which will send all random requests by changing the IP address. So you can try out that extension, really helpful. The other way to bypass your authentication or rate limit is other way to bypass the rate limit only is like by changing the user agent. So I have seen some of the time they do validate with respect to the user agent. So this is one of the IP ways. So you can use different header also like X forwarded for at X originating or X remote IP or X remote address. These are the header that you can use basically. Now other thing is you need to check for the user agent. So based on user agent also sometime there will be some protection for rate limit. So try changing the user agent to, let's say I'm changing for, let's say I'm just Google and show you user agent, okay, for Safari browser. Or you can say Chrome browser, IE browser. So try all those different user agents. So this is one of the like Safari browser or user agent for iPhone, right? So I have seen these kind of bypasses in my past also. So let's say this one, if I'm going to use, right, as my user agent. So I'll just simply go ahead and remove this and replace this value and try send it. So this also sometimes result in bypassing your rate limit protection. So these are some of the way you can basically bypass your rate limit protection if there is an account lockout or something in your place, right? Now, regarding the JWT token, I have made a complete video on JWT token. Please go ahead and watch that. I have talked about all those 6 to 7 variations of performing attack on JWT token. So I'm sure that will be really helpful for you. One another thing that most of the time developer use is OAuth, which is also recommended, but OAuth is really secure. However, if you have configuring it properly or improperly, then there is chances of vulnerability. So there will be something known as redirect URI parameter. So if you could see here in the link, so if the redirect URI parameter typically will have, like, let's say I am configuring OAuth for my xyz.com only, so I should have a whitelisting for xyz.com. But if it is not been whitelisted properly, then it can send the value to somewhere or some different domain also, which will be consuming the OAuth token and perform various attacks. So it's really, really important to validate this redirect URI parameter value for checking with different domain name you can try, or let's say like different server IP address, and try see if you can bypass over there. Now there is other thing, like always try to exchange for the code and not tokens. So this is another way of attacking OAuth token. So these links are already there in my video description. So please go ahead and check all of them. So I have just talked about this rate limit. Now another thing is HTTPS. So over here, we just didn't bother to check. So one of the really, really important or high impact vulnerability or critical, I would say, is like target is on HTTP. So most of the time, you will not be having HTTP, but you will be having this HTTPS, especially in API. So if it is in HTTPS, so try changing it to HTTP and send it a request. If it is working, then again, you got another vulnerability, right? So you can perform, or anybody can perform MITM attacks. So always do check for this thing also while performing security testing on your API. So I will just stop this video over here. And if you need me to explain about any particular vulnerability, do write in the comment box. I will definitely try and make it. I think some people might get bored about this lengthy video. So let's make it some other day. Okay, so let's make it some other day. So this is pretty much it about. So I will, some other day I will cover about few more vulnerability, not only about IDOR. We will see some of the more attack, like let's say XXE or things like SSRF and all those things. So this is pretty much about this part 2 video. If you like this video, do like, share, subscribe my channel. Do comment in the comment box if you have any query or if you wanted to me to explain some specific demo about some of the attack, which I will definitely try and make some video. And thanks for watching. Have a great day.